Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's BizEssentials webinar. I'm Amy Stark, Director of Administration for FCSI of the Americas. We're excited to have you here this month for BizEssentials webinar. I have a couple of announcements before we get started, but we'll give it a few minutes to let everybody get in, get settled, and we'll be back in just a second.
For the thousands in attendance and the millions watching around the world, ladies and gentlemen, let's get ready to rumble!
Hi again, we're ready to get started. I have a few announcements, as I said. First, welcome again to this month's BizEssentials webinar. We're so excited to have you with us. I wanted to give you a reminder that we are getting together as an FCSI the Americas family next Wednesday, December 16th at 5 p.m. Eastern for our holiday happy hour. We will have a great trivia contest with the winner receiving a brand new pair of Apple EarPod Pros. There will be prizes, more prizes handed out and holiday cheer. So mark your calendars for next Wednesday, December 16th at 5 p.m. Also, our first episode in the On Tap series will air Tuesday, January 5th. During each of these weekly episodes, FCSI Executive Director Wade Kaler interviews a different consultant member. Join us, join Wade, as we introduce you to members of the FCSI family and get an insight into the different diverse perspectives and personalities that contribute to the unique culture we have here with FCSI of the Americas. To be sure you don't miss any of the episodes, subscribe to the series on the FCSI YouTube channel. Now, notes about the webinar. Please use the Q&A feature on your screen to submit any questions for Debra. She'll take some of them later on in the webinar. And also remember, if you miss anything on today's webinar or want to rewatch previous episodes, the recorded BizEssentials webinars are available on the FCSI at the Americas website. So Debra, I'm going to toss it over to you and let you kind of get us started. And first to say thank you to our sponsor for today, which is Hobart Food Equipment Group. And Debra will get us started with some words from them.
Okay, terrific. Thank you so much. Let's get started. I'm excited about the third part of the Small Screen Big Impact series. We'll start with a few words, as you said, from Hobart.
Hello, everybody. My name is Shane Varnum. I'm the Director of Consultant Services for Hobart and for Trawlson. On behalf of all of us, we're happy to sponsor today's spotlight video, Right for Action in a Small Screen. This has certainly been a trying year. None of us thought that 2020 was going to bring across a pandemic. While our industry has evolved, much has remained the same, our people. Things about our industry reminds us that hospitality, breaking bread, all of those things that we used to take for granted will never be more important when we finally turn a page to 2020 and it becomes the answer to a trivia question. As we enter the holiday season, we have much to be thankful for. We're thankful for each other. We're thankful for our industry. We're also thankful for organizations such as FCSI. My FCSI has brought us together for this spotlight video. Thank you, everyone. Have a great rest of the year, and may 2021 be better than 2020. Thanks and stay safe. Enjoy today's spotlight.
Okay, yes, let's hope that 2021 is a better year than 2020 for sure. So welcome to Small Screen Big Impact. Many of you have seen this, maybe the third webinar in the series that you have seen, and we're going to talk today about how to write for action. Some of you already have met me. I am Debra Jasper, founder and CEO of Mindset Digital. We help organizations compete and get up to speed in a fast-forward world. We have been talking this year about the challenge of how to do business and create impact in this new world of social distance. So when I first kicked off this webinar months ago, this webinar series, we talked about how virtual is the new reality, at least for now. We were talking about the impact, of course, on the current crisis. And I just captured these headlines yesterday. So lots still happening, of course, in the restaurant space, as well as just in every space out there. We are all struggling with how we are going to get back to business as usual. And in the meantime, small screens and doing business on small screens is creating big challenges. I feel like all of us right now are feeling a lot of Zoom fatigue. We're kind of exhausted with between the webinars and the Zoom meetings and all of that. And of course, so much of what we do is happening online. So in the first series, I talked about your online presence and how to get that up to speed. Then we delved in last time into virtual meetings and presentations. And today we're going to talk about email messages and marketing and how those have to be designed for a small screen as well. I often say the old skill is you got to talk on the phone. The new skill is how do you write for a phone? Because so much of what we're reading from our mobile phones or from a very small laptop screen, and you just can't fit much in this space. So your audience, as I've mentioned, has less time, less attention, and less space to communicate in. So let's dig in today and talk about three key ways to design emails and messages for a very small screen. Remember, if you have questions, type those in, and Amy and I will talk through those before we wrap up today. And we know that every touch point matters now more than ever because we're not running into people and we're not able to have lunch with folks. And so now we have all these micro moments, and every single little moment we have with the client is a critical opportunity to shape a major decision. And I'll tell you, what's one of the most common touch points we still have with clients and colleagues? It still is email. Sometimes people will say, really, do you think of email as a digital outreach? But absolutely. And we are in pain over our inbox. I often say we're in triage. You know, I used to kick off my main stage keynotes by saying, how many of you, first thing you do when you get up in the morning is figure out what you can delete without opening it? And it's really all of us are doing that. When a long email like this comes in, are you reading it? If you're like me, it probably gets into your to-do Saturday pile, which becomes your to-do never pile. So that is a big challenge for us. On average, professionals get 147 emails a day. Contently says that it would take us 2.5 hours a day to get through our email. We don't have that budgeted in our calendars, right? So, and of course, what percentage are we reading on mobile? More than 50% of messages are being read from a mobile phone. So think about that. Here's a challenge. Maybe you send a client or even a colleague an email and they stop reading up at the top. And of course, your meeting request was at the bottom, or some critical question is at the bottom. So you've got to start thinking about how you front load your emails for today's hyper distracted audience. I'm going to give you in this webinar today some just pro tips to make your emails and even your messages rock. And it all starts with what we at Mindset Digital call SOS. How do you save time and save your emails? Everything that goes out the door, and this isn't just emails, it's your reports, it's your client letters, has to be short, organized, and skimmable. That is the formula, short, organized, and skimmable. You want to develop that SOS habit. It's also true for your websites, your proposals, your client reports, your presentations, and I'll give you a couple of examples of that in this webinar as well. So let's talk a little bit for a moment about short. You've got to keep it plain and simple. A friend of mine, and I just love this, used to say to his colleagues, you don't have time to read War and Peace, and I don't have time to read it. And I feel like all of us are feeling like that. So what is the best length for an average email? It's less than 100 words. There's a famous saying, I'm sorry I sent you this long letter. If I'd had more time, I would have written a shorter one. That's because it's tough to get down to what's most essential to share. It's not just about shortening the content, though. It's also about the words you use. Getting rid of jargon is absolutely critical. And of course, even in just every industry, we all are talking in our tribal language. So what reading level works best for email? I think this is a little bit of a surprise. Only one grade level has a higher than 50% open rate. It's the third grade. So I often say to people, because they'll say, Debra, are you saying we have to dumb it down? And I say, no, but you do have to break it down. Because we're just, we're in triage, too much coming at us. So you have to simplify for me so that I can take in your key messages. So here's a quick tip for you. This is a very easy tip. Well, it's not easy to do, but it's easy to understand and easy to act on. I'll stand up for a moment. No more than three syllable words per paragraph in your emails. And if you want to check your accessibility score, you want to be writing at a readability score of 65. So take a note on that, jot that down. If you want to take your next email campaign or even your website language, drop it in at readable.com and it will give you your accessibility score. And again, the goal is 65, at least higher than 50. The higher the score, the easier it is for me to take in your content. If you get below 39 or, 40, you're starting to be harder to read than a hospital HIPAA notice. So you've got to start thinking about writing clearly. And I was, a friend of mine was at the ball field and snapped this image. And I just think it's funny because, of course, what are they saying? They're just saying no smoking. We got to get rid of our jargon. And so many of us are just overcomplicating our messages. And today, I've been talking about this. Our audiences are not just distant. We're distressed. And the brain science is pretty clear. When we're distressed, it's harder to remember and it's harder to learn and harder to take in complex information. So plain words are easily understood. This is especially true for those of you who are reaching out to CEOs or C-suite executives. The higher up people are in an organization, the fewer words they want to see. So be thinking about that. Second is organized. Let's think about that for a moment. You want to make the call to action clear. Here's what's often going on. We're in a hurry. So we're typing out our emails and trying to get through our inbox. And we think, oh, the client will understand what we mean. They'll take this in. But that is magical thinking, people. What is really going on is when you send out long, confusing, or meandering emails, the client is confused and impatient, or even your colleagues. No one wants to be, I always hear from people in organizations who say, oh, when Sarah or Tom send out this email, they're always so confusing. So you don't want to cause pain for people. Before you send your next email or just even your text message, ask, can your client or your colleague understand the action that you're asking them to take at a glance? Sometimes I think there's nothing worse than calling up an email and thinking, I have no idea what they're asking me to do. And we have all been there. Clear writing reflects clear thinking. Think about that for your proposals too. So think about how much heavy lifting we're doing through emails and messages. You're trying to get people to review your proposals or sign the paperwork or get a meeting or take a survey. And too much is overwhelming. And when so much is coming at us, we just shut down. So we also at Mindset Digital say, think ARC. I use this all the time. Every message that goes out the door, you should have at least a clear call to action, clear recommendation, and clear context. If you have a recommendation, I mean, your recommendation may just be, let's meet on Tuesday, but it should always be clear to people what you're asking them to do. And if you need someone to make a decision, you want to tee it up. Here's my favorite example. A lot of us send emails like this. Hey, it'd be helpful to get a quick update on your kitchen design work, or, let's talk next week. Let me know what works for you. When you say, let's talk next week, what works for you, what are you actually doing? What you're doing is you're giving me the homework. You want me to go to my calendar, figure out what time would work and get back to you. It's just going to take me longer. It's harder to get me to do that. Instead, it's always important to give me at least a starting point. Does 3 p.m. on Tuesday work? If not, let me know what does and I'll coordinate. If that way I can say, oh, well, let me go to Tuesday, December 10th. No, 3 doesn't work, but 11 does. Now I'm already in my calendar. This little tip alone will get you much faster responses. And notice how I'm pulling out the time and the date. It all, you always start with the time, then you do the date. I even make that bold so that, and I, you know, bullet point it so people can easily see what I'm asking them to do. You will get much faster responses. Here, you're passing the ball on to your client. Here, you're advancing the ball and helping your client get started on getting back to you. So brief plus specific equals clear. That will save you time and earn you faster responses. It's funny, I've done a lot. I used to do a lot of these sessions live, and I had worked with a client and I was in DC talking with them, and someone stood up in the middle of the meeting and said, I'm scheduling 3 times more meetings this way. It has saved me so much time. Though some folks have said, I'm getting my Saturdays back, which is terrific. So remember, you are writing for a small screen. I do want to give a nod to, you only have in your subject line about 35 characters if you are reading an email on your phone. So keep that in mind. This is a real email that we got in our inbox, and here's what it looks like from a cell phone. You may open it. That may have a high open rate, but be thoughtful about what your subject line looks like on a cell phone. Finally, as part of the short organized skimmable, you want to think about skimmable. And what do we mean by that? Create headers. What do I mean by that? When you send a long email, of course, I only have so much time to read it. So if it's confusing, I will spend all the time I have puzzling through, and then I just have a little bit of time to take action. If it's clear, I don't have to spend much time puzzling through, so I have more time to answer and respond to the email. This is why newspapers, of course, have always done headlines, and it's why we should do headlines in our emails too. People don't think about this much. So I was working with Kettering Health over in Ohio, and they were trying to get volunteers to sign up to help them measure one of their platforms. And the email looked like this. You know, it was long and kind of hard to get through. They rewrote it after the training that we did. You know, I did a session, a workshop like this, and she came up and said, Debra, this is great. I rewrote this email. I had to send it to you. I did a clear call to action. So up high, first 8 words, looking for volunteers from each facility to review downtime reports. They also used bullets and made it much more skimmable. Here's the details, here's the schedule, here's how to sign up. They're using headers. Here's the before email, here's the after. In the before, she got no volunteers. In the after, she got 5 volunteers. So think about that. Headers are easy to skim and they will help you drive faster responses with your content. Bottom line is, we can't keep sending out painful emails. Better emails will save you time, drive action, allow you to get more done. And because, of course, which email will I answer? The one that is short, organized, skimmable, and easy for me to know what you need me to do. So this was kind of an aha for me. But when people say no one ever gets back to me, partly that may be because you're sending out long, meandering emails that are hard to respond to. So how quickly people respond can depend on you. If you think about the payoff here, because you may be thinking, what is the big deal about email? But when we have so much, if we can save a minute on most of the emails that we send out, that's 2.5 hours a week. That is more than 3 weeks a year. I don't know about you, but I can think of a lot of ways that I'd like to spend 3 weeks a year. I love to ski and that is my boat. So, you know, I'd much rather be boating than working on email. When you communicate with clarity, you have impact and it raises your gravitas in your organization. It is worth spending some time thinking about that touch point that you have with a client that is email. And as I mentioned, someone actually also said, I got my Saturdays back. I'm not spending it drowning in email anymore. You will get a tip sheet. FCSI will be sending out a tip sheet for you guys on short, organized, skimmable, and best practices after this webinar. I do want to do a shout out and say this is not just email. You think about it, it's your reports, you know, it's communication. All of it is driven by writing. And I want to give you three tests. So I was just looking around online to show you this example, and I found a commercial kitchen planning and design company. I changed the name, so this is not the real name, no shout out. But here's what they're saying. It's a full service food service design and equipment supply company offering conception to completion services, including consulting, design development, engineering, project management, and installation. That is a long sentence. It's kind of a lot to get through. So one of the tests to determine whether your writing, whether your website language or your emails are good, is just the read aloud test. If you go back, you think, would I talk like this? Would I ever, if I was talking to a client, would I say, we offer conception to completion, consulting, design, development, engineering. It starts to be that kind of blah, 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 right? So the read aloud test. If you read aloud and you think, I wouldn't really talk this way, then you don't want to write that way. You want to write like you talk, not like you text, but write like you talk. It's good writing today is more casual, informal, and friendly writing. Again, casual does not mean careless, but it does mean friendly. The second one is the three-syllable test. This I talked about earlier, no more than three syllable words per paragraph. So think about that. It goes back to accessibility scores. I told you you want to be at about 65. And if you take a look at that website language and you just go through and you count the three syllable words, in one sentence, not even in one paragraph, there are 14, no more than three. You've got to rethink this. This is harder to read than a HIPAA notice and the Harvard Law Review. So be thinking about, just check out your content and take a look at where you fall in terms of accessibility scores. Check your score. Again, you can go to readable.com and check it there. You can also get accessibility scores under spell check. So you can check there if you want to turn that on as well in Word. You want your score to be 65. Just be always mindful of, is your everyday language really everyday language? Or are you talking in language that's more of your tribal language and more jargony than it needs to be? And three is the breath test. If you need to take a breath from a paragraph or from a sentence, then you have to rewrite. We were doing this with a client one day, and they had to take a breath for a bullet point. That is not a bullet point. So you've got to shorten those up. You just can't write like this and hope that people are going to tune in. Here's a quick trick to keep it simple. Pay attention to your first eight words in every paragraph, especially your opening. So instead of saying it's a full service food service, which is hard to say, design and equipment supply, and I know that's more than eight words, the first 10 words. What if you said designing your world-class kitchen is at the heart of everything we do? It's much more effective, much more compelling, and puts your client at the center of the language. So pay attention to the first eight words. I will say that SOS, you know, it takes some thinking. Simple is hard, but it's definitely worth the investment. And you guys have a lot of complex language that you use. So getting it down to what's most essential to share is critical, because think about all of the complex things, the showcasing designs, you're communicating through multiple channels, all the things that you're doing that are complex. So just take a moment and ask yourself, if your content really does pass these tests, the breath test, the read aloud test, and the three syllable test. And if it doesn't, I would encourage you to just start to take some notes and think through, what are the barriers standing in your way to more simplicity and to just better, simpler, easier content for your clients and colleagues to take in? Because you don't want people spending all their time deciphering what you mean. You want people spending their time deciding so that they can make decisions. So think about how you could apply SOS everywhere. I will say, and I like this Onion cartoon, you are not alone. Every industry is struggling with this. In fact, Churchill once said, if we do not get to the point, we are going to lose World War II. So every leader, every organization struggles with trying to get to complexity. I will pause there and just remind you that please ask any questions you may have. Amy, let me know if there are any questions. I could answer one or two now, or I can keep going.
Well, I do have one quick one. And you mentioned in one of the email video or email pictures you shared just a minute ago, you had a picture actually in the message. Is that something that you think is a good idea to put within, you know, if we have an email out to, I think that one was the hospital. The question is, should we be including images in our everyday emails?
You know, she did that because I thought it was cute and help wanted, right? And it was an internal email. A lot depends on the client. Some people struggle to even see images in emails, depending on whether they're highly regulated or not. The other thing is sometimes when I see images and they look pitchy, I think, oh, this is an ad, and it gives me permission to just not read it. The answer, of course, is always depends on who are you sending it to. Are they more visual? Would they be more likely to read it or not? And you have to do some A-B testing to figure that out if you're doing an email campaign. Sometimes we'll just do a plain text and an email campaign, depending on what we're sending out and who the client is. So it can be an effective tool, but you have to think through it. Anything else on that front?
That's it for right now.
Okay. So please keep the questions coming because I'll answer more at the end. I want to talk for a moment about tone in email, and not just in email, but in everything else we do, because people are struggling, especially now. It's just harder to figure out tone over small screens. It is a challenge. It's just getting trickier. You don't want to be ego ed. We all know ego ed. You don't want to be Kurt. We see that a lot out there too, or pushy Paula, where it's all about her and not anything about you. So you have to be thoughtful about that. You want to prime for the positive. And here's what I mean. I was actually the opening keynote speaker at the Drucker conference a couple of years ago for Edward Jones, and I was the closing speaker, and the opening speaker was from Disney. And I love this question. He said, if you go to Disney and you ask a cast member, talk about priming, what time does the Magic Kingdom close? What are they primed to answer? It will be open until 10 p.m. They do not repeat the word close. They do not talk about it being closed. It's a great example of priming for the positive. So if you work with me, if someone emails you and says, can Debra meet at 10 a.m.? The person who works with me will not say, unfortunately. We have banned the word unfortunately. Instead, we'll answer with what we can do. I can make tomorrow morning work. Are you free at 9 a.m.? Start with what you can do, not with what you can't. It's a very simple rule, but once you start thinking about it, it takes a little bit to implement. And some of it is as simple as, instead of saying, I can't get that to you on Friday, you'll say, I can get that to you on Friday. We work a lot in insurance, and agents always want to say, we help you avoid disaster. What does the client hear? Disaster. So be thinking about how you're priming for the positive, and your tone does influence trust. So you think about email campaigns, even invoicing can be a lot friendlier. Don't make me a number. So here's a good example, and Amy, I'll call on you. I didn't tell you I was going to do this, but just guess, is this a number or a real person? Do you think that they're thinking of me as a number, or does it make me feel like they know me?
Your most recent is available online. Oh, they don't know me.
It's a number, right?
It's a number.
Yep. One more. Now they're using my name. Is it a number or a real person?
That's a little closer to being a real person.
At least they're using my name, but
yes,
it's kind of numbery, you know, it's not very friendly.
Yeah.
So, okay, thanks. So now I'll give you an example of what it's like to really think of me as a person. And I'm going to use car sales emails, but not this kind of car salesman or this one even, but the online ones. And take a look at Carvana. So my business partner recently bought a used car from Carvana, and she was just taken with how they did it. So they're like, hello, Elizabeth, very friendly. One thing that I find fascinating is they use the word you 7 times in this email. And I'll show you a couple more ways they're doing that. You've taken the first step. You can get your vehicle delivered to you as soon as tomorrow. Then I think this is super funny. She bought the car and they sent her a note saying, we hope we love your new wheels. And again, they used the word you 7 times. And then they said, do you want to watch your car dance? It's so excited that you bought it. Watch this. Your car is dancing while thinking about it. So that's kind of funny. And then of course they say, congratulations. Again, they're using the word you 7 times. They say, hey, you can get your Carvana gear. And then they end with, we'll even send you the new way to buy a car smell, which finishes off with a single tier of a car salesman. I do think when you look at this long paragraph, they could make it short, organized, and skimmable, but still funny, right? So this is an online transaction. They're trying to move you from awareness of their company down to action and then loyalty and advocacy. And they do that by showing that they are paying attention to you. In fact, they use the word you a lot and they want you to be a loyal fan. You've got to show me that you value me. Every touch point matters. And I think that is a great example of a micro moment that can make, you know, a series of micro moments that can make a big impression. Bottom line, when you leave the webinar, is I hope that you start to think about how you have all this information. You've got to get it down to what's most essential to share, because clear writing reflects clear thinking. And in this new virtual world, it's truly time to rethink how we communicate. Don't forget that, you know, sort of make a promise. If you want to think about 3 quick questions you can ask yourself, is that I will not send an email until I can answer what. What is this email or this message or this report or this website language about? So what? Why does my client care about this? And now what? What am I asking you to do next? So when you can do that, you will make a big impact. And then 3 other next steps. Start to think about how you're writing more compelling emails, creating these clear calls to action, and getting to the point much higher, so I know what you're asking me. And more specifically, let's just promise the next email when you get off this webinar that you send out today will be shorter than 100 words, only have 1 clear call to action, not 3, and will have no more than 3 syllable words. So again, we'll follow up with this tip sheet on the SOS habit. And before I wrap up, I will do a quick wrap up. Any other questions? What questions do you have?
So I have, looks like a couple. One is there a time frame for follow-up if someone doesn't respond to an email that's polite timeline?
I love that question. On our team, we say anywhere from 3 to 5 business days for clients. Internally, I may follow up with you that afternoon. Hey, but externally, you know, what we'll do for the next email is say, hi, Tom, we're circling back around. Did you get a chance to see these, you know, these times we suggested for this meeting? But typically 3 to 5 days. Now, if I followed up again and you still haven't responded, then you sort of get in the rotation, right? Then someone on my team might follow up in 7 days. But people are busy, and a lot of times people will be grateful that you ping them again, that you brought it back to the top of their inbox. They meant to respond. It's just, you know, if you got 150 emails coming in, you all those emails move to the bottom of your inbox pretty fast.
Right. So the next one is LinkedIn email and Facebook email, so using those as communication tools, are they treated the same as when we use Outlook or Gmail or something like that?
I don't think that the LinkedIn messages are a little bit different, because of course I have to go there to get it. And so that initial LinkedIn email, we often say that needs to be super personalized. I mean, you need to at least show me that you know something about me if you're inviting me to connect with you. And then after I connect with you, you can't just spam me, because then I will go unfollow you and I will not respond. You know, if your next email might be, it should show me that you know something about the work I do, and or that you know someone that I know, you know, that kind of thing. But typically what I prefer when we teach LinkedIn is we say, maybe you interact with me a few times, you engage on my posts a few times before you send me a note. I tend to think these days we have to earn a phone call, and we really have to earn a Zoom meeting, because we're all Zoomed out. So there has to be some strategy behind how you do that.
So another question, what about subject or what about signature lines in an email?
Yeah.
Is there a way that best practice for how much you put into your signature line?
Yeah. In my signature line, I have hyperlinks to my LinkedIn profile, you know, and then of course I just have, but I don't have a long address because we're trying to declutter. I do have my phone number and I do have my, of course, easy to email me. You already have my email, so I don't need that. I have my phone number and my link and how to link into me and probably the Facebook page for Mindset Digital, but it's all hyperlinked and it's very clean. I have someone who he's a partner that I work with. And I finally emailed him and said, you have to clean up your signature line. It is this long.
Yeah.
And every time you send me an email, you attach things. I have to scroll way down. And he wasn't hyperlinking to his LinkedIn profile. It had this long, messy address. And so I do think everything we do needs to be clean and crisp and very skimmable, even our signature line. So I like that. That's a great question. I should show his before to just show people how annoying that can be when you have to scroll way down. And also those long things that people put at the end with their, you know, most amazing thoughts, quotes and all that. Again, short, organized, skimmable. So the more you just want to declutter everything that you're doing.
What about chains of emails? So do you have any tips about, say, we're in like, you know, 7 or 8 deep on a response back
yes.
and forth? What would we, can we shorten that up a little bit for the same?
So these are great questions. And can I just say, so we have an entire masterclass in this. It's 3 webinars and 4 online courses. I mean, there's a lot. It amazes me that we all spend so much of our time on email and no one's been trained in it. You know, so I'm kind of, and I was a writer, as you know, I was a journalist for 20 years. So I came to email and said, we can do better with this. But yes, the number one mistake, the number one annoying thing that anyone tells me in a class is the reply all. There's nothing worse. You know, you send out an email to 40 people and then, or you're on a chain and suddenly you find out that Sarah can't make it to whatever. And you're like, I don't care. All of these people need to stop replying all. So first, I think if you're in an organization, you just have to have some policies on this. We do not allow reply all in my company because it just wastes everyone's time. We also have some policies around, let's say there's an email that goes out about a company picnic, but the 4th email back and forth is about a client event, something totally different. You have to change the subject line. The other thing that we caution people on is make sure that you delete all the emails below when you're going back and forth. Especially you might be sending someone to something, say you're sending me something to forward to a client, you've got to delete all the stuff below it because so often we'll send all that out. And again, we've got to make our emails crisp and very thoughtful because people are judging us. We're all getting judged in amazing ways because now I don't interact with you very much. So I'm really going to pay attention to whether you're sending me thoughtful emails. And it is an opportunity to either raise our gravitas or lower it. I was talking to we did this, a big training at a Fortune 100 company. And this leader decided not to promote someone because he didn't pay attention to grammar. And he thought she didn't care. And she thought he was just being, you know, kind of thoughtless. And not paying attention, not detail oriented. So I do think we're being judged in ways we may not know on email. And if you think if you're a kitchen designer and you're sending out errors in emails, people may think that you're not detail oriented when it comes to kitchen design. So I think we have to think through that really carefully.
What about subject lines? Do you have suggestions for, you mentioned, you know, when we're looking at our phone and the subject lines can get so cut off.
Yes,
best practices?
I actually have a 30-minute webinar on subject lines. So I have a lot of thoughts on subject lines because they are the most critical thing that we do. If you think about our subject in terms of we're making a quick decision about whether we're going to open your email. So subject lines have to be crisp and short and thoughtful. They have to have, if you can put a timeline in, just one simple thing. If you're trying to get a meeting with me on Friday, say Mindset Digital, meet on Friday, because then I know, oh, this is Thursday. I need to keep this at the top of my email and respond to you. So part of it is making sure that I know, is there a clear call to action? Now, what you can't do is urgent. I was giving a talk to 200 emerging leaders at a pharmaceutical company, and one of them said, no one ever responds to me, and I use urgent. And I said to all of them, how many of you put urgent in your subject lines? And they all raised their hands. And it's like, yeah, because you've lost your power. You know, if everything is urgent, nothing is. Right. So you have to be thoughtful. And instead of saying urgent, you can say due at 10 a.m. Then I know it's urgent. So we just have to think about how brief plus specific equals clear. Also, if you're just trying to get someone to open a subject line, curiosity helps a lot. So if you can make me a little bit curious, then people are more likely to open. But we do a lot of A/B testing, and they're doing some things now with AI where they're going to be able to predict which subject line will generate the highest open rate with 98% accuracy. I was just talking to a group that's doing that right now. So wow. pretty soon we won't be guessing on this.
How do you do your A/B testing? Do you have a client that helps you do those web A/B testing, or do you just kind of?
We have someone on my team who, you know, and we'll have a couple of options, and then we'll send it to different batches and just get a better sense of the response. Mm-hmm. We were doing a lot of open classes. We're not doing that anymore, but it was helpful when we were, because, you know, you just get a sense of this works and this doesn't. My favorite is we started taking out all the images. You were asking about that earlier. And I had a booth. We were this exclusive partner for LIMRA, which is the largest insurance association in the country. And people were coming up and saying, Debra, I thought that email was written specifically to me. I was getting individual responses. Now that is a good email. But right. I'll tell you, when you do email training, you feel very pressured to write really good emails. So hopefully this is helpful. I want to make sure that I'm wrapping up. Do we have any final questions?
We have one more. What about punctuation in a subject line? Does that get flagged by spam filters? And are there other things we should worry about with filters?
Oh, my favorite answer is, I think here's another big mistake I think people make. It's the exclamation point. You know, it is too car salesy, like act now or... they did a study on exclamation points, which I just thought was fascinating. I feel like I could lead a whole session on that. But it is, people feel like those are markety, and you don't want to sound spammy in your subject line. So we do have a session on, we call avoid the vendor voice, and I think it's critical. And how do you meet as equals with your clients? So partly I say mirror the tone. If your client won't use an exclamation point, you shouldn't. You know, I was working with a client the other day, though, and he's a PhD in psychology, just seems like a very serious guy. And he sent me a note with 4 exclamation points. I'm like, okay, well, then I will use them. So, because I'm like, I'm excited too. So if he's friendly and excited like that, then I will be. But if they're very serious and you think they would never do this in a million years, then I try to mirror the tone. I don't ever think there's a good reason to use 2 exclamation points at the end of one sentence. No one is that excited. It feels a little, you know, over the top. And so we help, that comes into meet as equals. You want to be seen as an advisor. You do not want to be seen as a vendor. And I think that's a very important distinction.
Right. I like that advisor as advisory email. Mm-hmm. I'm pushing on you email.
Exactly. We try hard to work on that advisor tone because, again, you know, everyone on this webinar has a lot of wealth of knowledge, and you're trying to help clients get to a solution. And you want your whole team to be in that advisor mindset. So when you say things like, thank you so much for your time, exclamation point, you're lowering your own, you're moving into vendor voice when you do that. And what you're really trying to do is show them that you're bringing a lot of value to the table. So you want to stay as equals. And that makes a big impact on how people perceive you. So hopefully that is helpful. Let me wrap up, Amy. And yeah. If you guys have any other questions, you should link into me. So I will give you my LinkedIn address because I'd be happy to talk further. But as I just pointed out, even an amazing webinar, which I'm not saying this one was, but you know, a 45-minute webinar is not a new habit make. So we didn't get to get into persuasive openings. I will say short does not mean rude. So I always want to make sure it's fine. I don't like it when people say, Debra, can you do this? It feels like you're barking at me. I want you to say hello, Debra, at least. So we do talk a little bit about spark, which is a persuasive opening, and then the action, recommendation, and context. You know, we didn't get to talk about active voice versus, passive voice or how you get from vague to actionable. There's a lot of stuff, of course, we couldn't cover. We do coach in that. So if anyone wants to talk more about those courses, let me know. But LinkedIn, because I'd love to hear your thoughts to anyone on the webinar about how you're writing or what annoys you. I just like hearing people. Overall, to inform, we must first engage. That's really where we are today. Our clients, they just have too much info. They're busy, distracted people. And we have to get to clarity and impact on a small screen, whether we are presenting, whether we are on LinkedIn, or whether we're writing. So I hope this small screen big impact has given you a sense of how to effectively move from this to this, because it is such a new world and we all have to adopt new approaches if we have any hope of competing in today's virtual age. And of course, combating Zoom fatigue. I will say I saw this the other day where you can invite a donkey to come to your next virtual meeting, which that could cheer things up, or even an alligator or a camel or a penguin, apparently. So people are getting creative. I was working with the CMO the other day at Ohio Health, and she actually sort of made herself look like Nemo the fish to talk to her team, which I thought was great. So people are getting very creative, and we're all working hard to break through the noise. So please link in, let us know how it goes. I'm so excited that I got a chance to work with you guys on how to make a big impact on a small screen. And I hope to come back and do more work in the coming year. So Amy, I will turn it over to you and let you wrap up.
All right. Well, thank you again for joining us for all three of these webinars, Debra. We really appreciate it. And thank you again to Hobart for sponsoring this month's webinar. And don't forget that a recording of today's event will be available online. I usually have them up by the end of the week. And at the same place that you will find today's webinar, you'll also find the past versions of all of Debra's webinars and the other webinars we've done for the BizEssentials series. And again, don't forget about our happy hour next Wednesday, December 16th at 5 p.m. And I also wanted to share with you, some of you may have seen this already, but our new promotional video for the ONTAP series, which will begin in January, and Debra can hit start on that so you can all see it.
Oh, I couldn't download it. I'm sorry. Okay. I just couldn't do the screenshot of it. Yeah. So I'd have to go there to do it. But yes, so they should go and look at it. Yes.
You're going to have to go to YouTube. But that's okay. Cool. So go to our YouTube channel. When you go to look at BizEssentials things, you'll also be able to see Wade and our new promo. And Wade shared the link for you guys in the chat. So those of you who can just grab hold of that in the chat, you can look at our video for next month. So again, thank you, Debra. Thank you, Hobart. And thank you all for joining us. And we will see you next week for Holiday Happy Hour. And again, for the next BizEssentials webinar in January.
Thanks so much, Amy.
Yeah, thank you, Debra.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.